Three, two, one. Hey, YouTubers, this is Doug with stormchasingvideo.com. We're back again with another one of our behind the chases. Yes, I know before anyone makes any comments going, hey, you said you're going to do this every week. Well, for the last 2 weeks, we got a lot of active weather here. So didn't think you'd be wanting to watch me talking about stuff we've already chased versus stuff that we were currently chasing that was pretty insane. It was just pretty much nonstop for the last 2 weeks trying to keep caught up with everything here. So. But we're back again for another one of our little webisodes here, and we got a really cool thing tonight. We got Tony Laubach, who just got his master's degree, and he's like a master of storm chasing. So, Tony, what are you a master's of now?
I've got a master's degree in media management and production. I just finished it up literally about 2 weeks ago.
And what other degrees do you got?
Well, I've got a bachelor's degree in meteorology and technical communications, so I'm actually one of the few people out there chasing storms who's a meteorologist. You don't see me on TV because I actually am right more times than the ones on TV because I put myself on the line in terms of gas and money to make sure I'm right.
All right. So now going back to Bowdle.
Well, actually, Bowdle was kind of an interesting day. We had chased the day before. I was out with the Twistex group, so Tim Samaras, Carl, and all those guys. We were out the day before, and we had actually stopped. I can't remember exactly what town it was in Nebraska, and we were going to chase Kansas or take a down day. That was actually our plan going into the night. So we stayed up late, had a late dinner, and went to bed. And about 6 o'clock in the morning, Carl comes banging on the hotel room door, and Ed and I are sharing a room. And he comes banging on the door. He's all dressed and ready to go. Says, guys, we got to be on the road in 15 minutes. And, of course, Ed and I are half asleep, like, what, what? And he's like, we're going to South Dakota. Loading up the cars in 15 minutes. Literally, I have no idea what they looked at or what time they got up to do all this crap, but they came tearing into the hotel room and basically said, we need to be up and out the door in 15 minutes. So Ed and I get our stuff together. We go sprinting out of the room. We jump in the cars, and we head off. And I think it was about, I want to say it was about a 7-8 hour drive. I remember it was quite far, which is why we needed to leave
so early. Ouch, yeah. Those 7 and 8 hour drives after getting a few hours of sleep suck when you're chasing. Especially, you were on the road for, what, like a month and a half already with the show for Storm Chasers?
Well, the day before, we were going to go into Colorado, and we'd stayed the night in Goodland the night before that, and Tim had a data logger that he was putting in this new tower probe that he had built. That one failed. He had a new one back at the house, so Ed and I actually ran back to Denver the day before. And I think the target that day was supposed to be like northeast Colorado, southeast Wyoming, and they ended up all the way in the Nebraska panhandle or something. So we went from Goodland to Denver to get the stuff at his house, then back out to try to meet them. So I had a, you know, horrible time trying to keep up with them because, of course, they were further east than we thought they were going to be. So by the time we'd met with them, of course, that day was over. So Ed and I had already driven like all day the day before going to Denver and back to go and get the data logger for Tim's probe.
So you get up into South Dakota, and so how long did it take for the forecast to evolve and for storms to, you know, basically get firing?
Well, we arrived outside of, I can't even remember the name of the town, some small town out, you know, just to the southwest of Bowdle, and we got out there about mid-afternoon, and we were sitting around just kind of in this field, and we were watching the turkey towers going up, and I'd say it was about an hour, hour and a half after we got there, and you could feel the day was going to happen. I remember sitting in the car having a discussion with the camera people. We had Discovery Channel with us, telling them I felt like this was going to be the big day of the year for us, and everybody was out. We were just having a good time, and then the storms went up literally right on top of us, and we pretty much were on our first tornado within 45 minutes of initiation.
So let's look at the video here, and let's take a look and see what's happening here.
Well, Bowdle was actually like our third or fourth tornado of the day. The supercell that we had followed had produced several tornadoes leading up to Bowdle, and we intercepted. And our goal that day for Twistex was to deploy Tim's tower probe, which is a 2-foot tall probe that had instrumentation at 0.5 meter, 1 meter, and 2 meters. And the day before, when Ed and I went and got the data logger, it was to replace the one in that probe. So the goal for the day was to try to deploy this probe into the tornado. And the main east-west road we were on when the tornado was initially forming, we were able to get in position. We actually deployed that probe into that tornado early on in its life cycle before it became the monster that it did. And we took readings out of that as it took a direct hit pretty much in front of Ed and I in our car. And, of course, Tim and company were on the other side, east of the tornado at that point. So our focus at that point was to get that probe into the tornado, which we did very early on.
All right, so what are we seeing now in the video here?
All right, this was after the probe deployment that we had with Twistex. The probe deployment took place early in the tornado's life cycle. At this point right now, we were focused on mesonet operations. Tim and his probe truck were actually further north up the road, fairly close to where they were thinking the tornado was going to cross. And then I was in one of three mesonet vehicles that were taking readings of the RFD, the winds wrapping around the south side of the tornado. Ed Grubb and myself were actually in the vehicle, and we were the second car in line. So we were the middle vehicle of the three. There was one group ahead of us and then one group behind us. And at this point, we were positioning a mile apart. Our goal was to try to be within a mile of each vehicle. So we had a 3 mile spacing, and we would all take the readings at the same time as the RFD of this tornado was sweeping through.
And for those of you who are not familiar, Tony likes to put out joke grenades. And when you're watching this, you know, when he sends in the video, you see the cemetery in the foreground, and he likes to call it a grave situation.
Yeah, I'm a little punny with that. It was a grave situation. I believe we were making all sorts of comments after the fact, obviously. During the tornado, we were focused on other things, but
yeah.
I have a knack for filming tornadoes near cemeteries, I found out over the years.
Well, there's a lot of them out there. How wide do you think this tornado is at this point? I mean, it's big. It is, you know, this thing looks like it means business.
I think the tornado is between 3/4 and a mile wide at this point. It was certainly at its strongest right around this particular point in the video.
Now, do those cameras that you kind of see going in and out, did those ever get in your way when you were filming for the show?
No, those small cameras are usually mounted pretty far on the outside. In fact, I have kind of taken liberty in doing that myself with cameras that I have, little action cameras I have mounted on the top corners of the windshield on the inside, and with the lenses as wide as they are, they get the interior of the car pretty well, and they stay out of the way for the most part.
Now, kind of see the reflection, you know, that looks like an old GPS in there, but sometimes when you watch Tony's videos, you also see a little doll in his videos. You know, explain that while we're, you know, watching this thing,
yeah,
kind of get in the scene here.
I'm very superstitious in my storm chasing. You'll see the reflection. It's actually a Super Mario Brothers Goomba with a green hat that has an L on it, which technically stands for Luigi, but I brag it stands for Laubach. And that's my good luck charm. His name is actually St. John Francis Seymour McLean, named after the first four tornadoes he witnessed in my car.
Let's see, the red car that just pulled up, that's actually Scott Weber Powell's car pulling the scene. Now you got we're looking at your steering wheel here, and you know, there's Scott in there, and you know, point out, I mean, you can see, you when you talk about it, you know, when you looked at your damaged stuff, you know, what are you seeing in the foreground behind Scott there?
Well, we are actually backing up at this point in the video because the RFD was actually getting so strong. There was a home, there was a building on the west side of the road right next to us. And when the winds really started cranking up, there was like a shingle or something, I don't remember, but some part of the roof flew off. And it was a small part of the roof, but it was enough where it hit the car that I said, we need to back up and get out of the way, because if the RFD was going to like blow the roof off this house, it was pretty much going to do it right where we were. So we backed up, trying to get out of the way in case that house did like go. We were not in the debris path. So I think where Scott was, where he was up in the video, I think he would have, where at least I would have assumed, been in front of it. So if that house had blown apart, it probably would have went between the two of us.
Okay. And you can kind of see the whole rotation here with that. And wow, look at that. So what just happened there?
There was a series of giant transformer poles or towers or whatever they were, and this tornado actually mowed down a bunch of them. That was a lot of the reason why the tornado got such a high rating of damage, because it actually scoured most of these off. But what you just saw in the video was one of the towers closest to the road actually crumpling over and falling as the tornado hit it.
That's insane. You know, I don't say insane that much, so that's crazy. Is that another one of the Twistex vehicles up ahead there?
Yeah, the two vehicles you see up there, there's a white car and then the mezzanette vehicle. Tim's car and the mezzanette vehicle were parked front to back up there, and they were about, I think at this point, just under a 3/4 of a mile away from where we were.
It looks like a major chaser conversions out there.
Yeah, this was the main highway north out of Bowdle, so there were a lot of, I mean, it was a perfect intercept road for everybody. The problem was this tornado slowed down significantly and actually almost never crossed the road. So we probably could have deployed a little bit better because that tornado had slowed down so much before it crossed the road. We all stopped, obviously, south of the tornado at that point, but it remained. I think what happened was as the tornado neared the road, it shrunk. So it's like forward progress actually was not hitting the road nearly as fast as the tornado was moving originally because it was shrinking and kind of going into it, starting its rope out stage as it was crossing the road.
Let's see here. At least 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 chasers, and you can still. Is that even? It's so hard to tell where it is right now when you're looking at the video.
It is, if you look at it right now, you can see it on the west side of the road. So if you're looking down the road at the video, it's on the left side of the road, literally like, I mean, you'd almost put it on the shoulder. You can barely see the outline of it. It's a cone at this point as opposed to the wedge it was.
Okay, yeah, it's very low contrast, and that RFD is just, you know, getting that rain curtains wrapping around there. It's making it really, if you don't know what you're looking for there, you know, that looks very dangerous when you'd be driving down there.
Yeah, it's not something you want to be driving down. I mean, even us as a group, we weren't trying to push any further north.
Now, where's the rest of the crew? Are they on the other side of the tornado now, or did they get out of there?
Everybody's south of the tornado. So Tim and the other, the first mezzanette vehicle are both up about 3/4 of a mile north of where we were. Then Ed and I were in the car there, and then behind us, probably about 3/4 of a mile, was the third mezzanette vehicle. So we had them lined up. All of us were south of the tornado at this point.
You're just getting hit by the rain bands on this now, or what's going on?
We're in the hard part of the RFD. I think this is where we started measuring 50 to 60 knot winds. With the rain bands. Obviously, we lost total view of the tornado at this point, but we were in some pretty intense winds rocking the car pretty good.
Well, if we play that game, I mean, that's the only road.
I'd be sweating just being that close right now because you can't see what's happening. It's very low contrast.
Well, I think Ed and I think we were measured to be about a mile and change south. I think Tim and the other mezzanette vehicle were within about half a mile of where it eventually crossed.
Roger.
Then we'll do exactly that. What do you want, M2 to pull out ahead and go out in front then? That's right.
Well, looks like this thing's just about done here, so let's swing over to the damage video.
This is the tower that I filmed crashing down in that tornado. We were 7/10 of a mile from this spot, from the intersection. From the intersection here, we were 7/10 of a mile. And there's the building that's in the foreground. And there is the radio tower that I watched go down in my video.
All right, so we're focused on the high tension transformer towers that were knocked down in the tornado, and there were a series of these that took direct hits. As you can see in the video, when I'm like not spinning around, many of them along the path of this were damaged directly by the tornado, and then there were others further down the line that when those towers went down, the wires actually pulled several of the towers down from like a mile away from where this tornado was. So I'm like imagining you're driving down the road and you're not seeing the tornado behind you, and all of a sudden these transmission towers come collapsing because the tornado is essentially pulling them down from the wires. But I've got a shot right here. As you're looking down the power lines, you can see each one subsequently like more destroyed, but there were a couple of them that were actually completely scoured from their bases, which actually was part of the reason the tornado got such a high EF rating.
What was the EF rating on that?
This tornado was rated an EF4, a high-end EF4. I believe there was talk of it being rated EF5 for some of the damage that was done to the transmission towers, but I believe they left it in an EF4 because it was not a... It did not do significant damage to a population center. It did pretty much destroy this farmstead, but they were able to find no traces of EF5 damage within a population center, so they left it in an EF4.
That definitely looks like EF4 damage to those vehicles there. The trees are pretty much stripped. Is that Ed walking through there?
I don't know who that was. Couldn't get a look.
Nice job site. And that's like wedged into the tree.
Yeah, I mean, there were, I mean, obviously, as you can see, there were all sorts of things wedged into these trees. There was, you know, obviously the cars. Cars were lofted from the driveway. Many of them were found several hundred yards away, obviously in the yard. Some of them were wrapped around trees. I wish I could remember. I know there was a lot of discussion because, I mean, a lot of the more scientific minds in the crew actually went out and GPS tagged specific pieces of debris and were actually trying to kind of locate where they came from. I think the shot here, I was scouring the ground and there was a red tractor out in the ding, and that was actually rolled all the way out there through that pond and into the field.
Yeah, these high tension lines look like they're just twisted up by a giant.
Yeah, and here in this shot you can see where the ground was scoured from the tornado, so you're kind of looking down the damage path, you know, where the tornado came across, which actually that was the first time I'd ever done that. I actually come back afterwards and seen where the grass and the ground was actually scoured from where this tornado went through. It was a very interesting thing to actually be standing in the middle of where this tornado...
Just looking at that, that just kind of gives you the sign of a strong EF4 to EF5. Yeah. Those high tension lines, you know, they know what it takes to break the bolts from that stuff.
Yeah, and there were a lot.
What is that?
I'm not sure what that was, but it was obviously wrapped around the lines. Those big cables you see are the high-tension lines that are stretched from those towers. So whatever that was got lofted. We're not sure if it was pulled into it or if it was already something that was on the ground, but obviously it was wrapped around.
That looked like a boat.
It might have been. It's like I said, it's hard to tell with some of what these things were after the fact because they get around crumpled so much. You know, this truck right here, you can see the signpost that was drilled through the car. So, I mean, it, you know, speaks volumes as to why we tell you not to be in vehicles when these things come rolling through. Obviously, if you were in this car, you probably didn't fare too well, but fortunately nobody was in it. But like I said, I'm panning up the signpost here, and you can see it's pretty much just wrapped into the car and ended up into the passenger seat.
Yeah, it went up and then back down the windshield there and wrapped around the post.
And of course, this white car just was absolutely obliterated. Here's a tree with a piece of metal sticking out of it. So that, you know, that's pretty intense right there.
That hit it like an axe.
As I was saying, that might be an axe right there, but that one obviously impaled into the tree.
That looks like an axe.
So, very intense winds with this to do that kind of damage.
You know, the chasers, we don't get to see that stuff that often, and if we do, we wanted to see it in the middle of nowhere where nobody's going to get hurt.
Well, unfortunately, that was the case with this. That if this had been just a mile or two south in the town of Bowdle, would have probably been wiped out.
So anyways, this is our video blog, or Behind the Chase, for this week. This is where we talk about, you know, what we've done, you know, either yesterday, today, last week, last month, last year, or last decade. And we have Tony Laubach here, and if you want to see more of Tony's stuff, go in the upper corner here to the card and check out his YouTube channel here. There's a link right to his channel to check him out. And providing we don't get slammed with weather here in the next 5 days, we'll be back again next week with another Behind the Chase. And if you get a chance, you can also go down below here on our channel and hit the subscribe button. So we'll see you next week, hopefully. Take care.